Hi, and welcome back to another video of jPlay. I'm Marcus, and today I want to have a look at the newest game by Stefan Feld, La Isla. When you compare this one with heavyweights like Amerigo or Bora Bora, La Isla is definitely much lighter. But this is definitely not a bad thing. In La Isla, players are adventurous explorers who try to hunt down long-thought extinct animals such as the dodo, the giant fossa, the golden toad, the Sardinian pika and the owlet moth. The player who plays his cards right, places his explorer into the appropriate spots, will find the most animals and will score the most victory points and, of course, win the game. Of course, no animals were harmed during the creation of this video, though. Even though it's a pretty small box, the game ships with lots of components. Especially the amount of cards, tokens and wooden pieces is definitely worth mentioning. And you don't see plastic miniatures very often in a Feld game. But fear not, he still hasn't designed his first Ameritrash game here. The game itself is absolutely language independent and it even comes with three versions of the rulebook. So you can expect English, French and German rules for this one. The icons on each card help to make the game language independent, but without the proper overview cards, also in three different languages of course, they don't make much sense. At least for me, but that's always the case. La Isla consists of this centerpiece and the 10 surrounding tooth-shaped types like this one here, so this is a modular setup. And the rulebook mentions that there are more than 100,000 options for what the island may look like. And nope. I have not tried them all, of course, but at least it's definitely a gain in respect to replayability. By the way, these tokens for the various animals are also placed randomly on the game board. Let's prepare the game and give each player one card holder, six explorers of the chosen color, five resources, basically one per color, and one large animal token by drawing one randomly. One of your six explorers goes to the victory point track and the remaining two explorers, as there are eight in this game, are set aside for possible later usage. Those card holders are also pretty unique and serve various purposes. For once, you store five of your starting explorers and your starting resources below the space with the letter C. And later you will use the card holder to place your cards during the first step in any given round. The game ships with 180 cards, which is quite a lot, whereas 120 cards show the value 1 and 60 cards show the value 2. The letter card type is for the more advanced players as they provide more sophisticated special abilities and such. And now for something completely different, as the starting player token goes to the oldest player on the table and not the youngest. But of course, you are free to define the starting player any way you want it. But now we are already good to go. The game round consists of five phases. First, you have the card phase, where each player draws three cards for the actual round and places those under the appropriate letter on the card holder, and four action phases, which are also depicted here on the card holder. But let's have a closer look at the cards first. Each card serves three purposes where you normally decide for one of those for each card. The first thing is the special action at the top of the card. If you want to leverage this, you have to place it under letter A of your card holder, but more about that in a second. You can also use the card for the resource it shows. So place the card under letter B of your card holder to claim that resource. And last but not least, you can move the marker on an animal track according to the animal shown on the card. If you want to use this card for this purpose, place it under letter D. I bet you expect to place it under letter C. Ah, gotcha. So, after the card phase, you have placed all your three cards from this round face down under your card holder. Then it's time to move over to the first action phase with the letter A. You take your card there and place it face up to the top of your card holder, like this, showing only the upper half of the card to show which special ability it provides. As you can see, your card holder can hold three abilities at the same time. When you place your fourth card in the fourth round, you have to cover an existing one, so you won't be able to use the special ability anymore. But there are two exceptions to that. As for example, you are still allowed to use your additional explorer that this card provides, even when it is covered during a later turn. There are various game effects that those cards provide, so I won't explain them to you in detail. If you want to see a walkthrough video, I really suggest to check out Mivi's channel, as he did an awesome video for La Isla. Maybe I will show you some special effects when I explain some further actions. There are some additional rules on how to place those cards, as you are not allowed to have completely identical cards in your active area. Similar functions are okay though. So, this combination would not be allowed, whereas this would be fine though. Let's move on to the action phase B, where you reveal your card there and just claim one resource depicted on the card at the bottom left. But if you would have this card in your active area, you would get an additional resource of that color if you claimed one. So in this example, if you claim this beige resource, you would gain an additional one. And again, there are so many different ability cards in play. For example, this one where you can get victory points when you claim this kind of resource, or you can move a marker up one space and so on. The main action phase C is not directly related to a card you played before. In this phase, you place your plastic workers on La Isla in order to corner the appropriate animals in order to gain the trophy token. Again, no animals have been harmed recording this video. Starting with the starting player and continuing in clockwise order, the players place one explorer from the available pool on letter C and place him or her on a landscape space of the game board, like this one. If you don't have any more explorers in your available pool, you can take one from any space on the game board. If you place your explorer on this landscape type, you have to pay two resources of that color, so yellow in this case. Again, there are various cards on how to change the outcome of this placement. This card, for example, will reduce the amount of resources needed for that type of space by one. And when you have this card in play, you gain three victory points when placing an explorer in that area type. Of course, those effects stack, and that's the reason why you are not allowed to have identical cards above your card holder. So if you have both cards in play above your card holder, basically you get both benefits. So for once you gain the three victory points because it's the area type here, and you reduce the amount of resources needed to place that explorer by one. If you don't want to place an explorer, or if you can't, you can grab one resource of your choice instead. When you have one explorer in spaces surrounding an unclaimed animal token, you are allowed to claim this token. For once, you score the amount of victory points that is printed on the animal space, and then you are allowed to keep this animal token, which will score you additional victory points. This can be pretty tricky, as you can score several animal spaces when you place your explorers right, like this one. On the other hand, you don't score points for empty spaces, of course. And last but not least, we resolve action D, and this is to move the animal marker for the depicted animal on the appropriate card. So, in this case, this would be the dodo track. This is a great way to score additional points, as you, and only you, get one victory point for each small animal token you have in your reserve for this animal, and two victory points if you hold the big animal token of that creature. Of course, the other players can score their cards under letter D accordingly. In this example, the blue player would gain two additional victory points because he holds two of the dodo tokens. You also get those victory points when you are allowed to move an animal track through the special ability of a card above your card holder, like this one, which allows you to move a marker when placing an explorer on the depicted type of landscape. Whenever you reach the topmost point of any given animal track, you cannot move it anymore, but you still can score those points. The animal track is also the indicator of when the game ends. At the end of each round, you sum up the values of the current marker for each animal, and dependent on the amount of players, the game might end now. So if you play with only 2 players, the game ends when the above sum is 7, 9 for 3 players and 11 for all 4 players. The game ends immediately, by the way. Let's move over to the final scoring. When the game ends, you get victory points for completed sets of all 5 animals. You get victory points for all of your animal tokens multiplied with the current multiplier for that animal on the animal track. And last but not least, you get victory points for your remaining resources. So in this example, this player has 2 completed sets, which brings him 20 victory points. And he scores 36 victory points for all his animal tokens multiplied with the current value of the animal track. And last but not least, he scores 3 points for his 3 remaining resources. And the player with the most victory points can name himself Charles Darwin, and of course he wins the game. As usual, I keep my final thoughts to a minimum, and as I am a big fan of Stefan Feld, it won't be that objective anyway. I really enjoyed this game, even though it's definitely not my favorite Feld game. As said, La Isla is definitely much lighter than other games by him, but it still offers a pretty deep gameplay. Each turn, your whole strategy might change according to the cards you just drew and which ability cards you have to cover now. Typical for Feld, there are so many ways to score points that you are a little bit overwhelmed during your first one or two games. But you get behind it pretty quick, and then you actually know what you are doing. For Euro fans, this is definitely a clear recommendation. It's relatively fast, but definitely not a filler game. I really hope you enjoyed my little review rule primer here, and hope to see you soon in one of my next videos. Until then, bye bye.